And the other thing is that they promise a rapid publication. There is a misconception that open access articles are not reviewed. Open access articles are being, you know, printed, they are being accepted at ease as compared to subscription-based model. It's not the case. What happens is that because the open access articles are not printed in a hard copy. So whenever open access articles are accepted, they would be present in an online version. So in that context, your article would be present in an online context soon as compared to subscription-based. And there is no limit for the number of words also, because that doesn't have to be printed in a hard copy. And the third point is that they doesn't need to be waited for us volume to be formed so that they can be put in a hard format. So open access doesn't lead to a rapid publication or rapid acceptance, but yeah, it's a rapid appearance on the website. And the publication charges, you bargain with these journals and they can publish anything for you for 1,000 rupees or 500 rupees, you know. And as rightly said, that the Springer or elsewhere, Wills and Ville, they charge around $3,000 for publishing an open access article. They have a very non-professional email address. They would be indexed in our agencies which are not accurately decepting a proper indexing agency. A journal which is indexed in Google Scholar is not called index. Google Scholar is nothing, is not our indexing agency. Okay. Index Copernicus. A journal, if it is present in Index Copernicus, be aware of that journal. But unfortunately, some of these predatory journals have found their way into a PubMed. But if you look at the accurate journal, the right journals, they would be either in Scopus or in Web of Science or ESCI or DOHA. These are the databases which actually index the proper journals. And they have a fictitious member of editorial board. You never know whether that editorial board member know exactly that he is a member of a particular journal. And sometimes what you feel is that, you know, editors of a different fields are being the editorial board members, and they sent you an invitation to become a reviewer, and they give you a certificate of publication. No good journal or publisher gives you a certificate of publication, and they always solicit. They send you mails which you, I think in the morning you will all receive these mails that, you know, publish in this journal. So these are the examples of which, through which you can distinguish predatory journals from a legitimate open access journals. And if you want to go to the list, the black list is created by Beals. And if you look at the white list, where actually the open access article journals are there, DOAJ one is there and COPE is another one. If a journal is indexing these two indexing agencies, COPE or this STM and DOJ, that means they are the proper legitimate journals. Okay? And so how do you think that every day, that's created by Bales, that who invented the comparative journal, and that's a standalone journal. So Bales is not directly involved nowadays, but his colleague is taking care of this list. DOAJ journals are valid. Directory of Open Access Journals. So right now, every day a new journal is being launched. So what is the criteria in which you can distinguish whether this is legitimate? So you have to think, do you have a colleague know this journal? Can you easily identify and contact the publisher? Is the journal clear about the type of peer review process? So it's very important. A proper journal will always have a proper peer review process. They will, on the journal website, they will keep it whether we follow a single peer review process, double blind peer review process, or triple blind peer review process. So, and then these predatory journal doesn't have any information on the peer review process they follow. And do you recognize any editorial board member? Is the publisher a member of COPE or DOJ? If answer is yes, you are always ready to submit in these journals. These are legitimate. So do you have any questions at this time? Or I believe that you have understood everything. But no comments or suggestions or some ideas on that, so that I move to next part. Perfect. So nice audience. So this is publishing ethics. Why I'm saying about the publishing ethics? Because being a research integrity group, I have to maintain every time, every day I receive a mail that there we have to investigate some unethical misconduct which has happened in an our journals. And so if you look at the COPE, that's a Committee of Publishing Ethics, which looks at the ethical misconduct. So they have seven parameters on which they judge an article. So whenever you submit an article, when it is online present, they look at these seven parameters and say that, you know, everything is right, check, check, check. If everything is right, they don't say, but if something has happened, then the retraction watchdog and other agencies write to us and say that this has happened. And one is carelessness in citation, redundant publication, unfair authorship, undeclared conflict of interest, human and subject violation, plagiarism, and data fabrication. So a lot of information has been covered by Professor Lakotia, but I will not go in detail into that, but I will give you an overview of what we are looking when we look at the manuscript and what actions we usually take. What is a negligent, careless, or citation bias? It's when you inadequately review an article, review any paper, and it's based on presentation of a data based on faulty statistical analysis. Suppose you are citing a review article and which has itself cited another article. So your responsibility is to read the actual source of an article rather than believing on the B source. So that's the way you, because every person have its perception to receive an information, to address that information. So it's important that you read the actual article. And this has happened recently in which one of our author was, you know, in introduction section, he was always positive about anti-malarial drugs he had found, and he was saying that, no, these are that couple of anti-malarial drugs which have been in the market in the trials and clinical trial 1 and 2. But he failed to cite those articles in which anti-malarial drugs or the molecules or the lead compounds didn't move from the laboratory to the bench site. And we raised this question, you know, everything is not so rosy. Why have only documented on the positive aspect of an anti-malarial compound, although there can be a positive aspect and negative aspect? So he has to draft an explanation. So that comes under a citation bias. And of course, a selective citation that supports a particular point of view. And selective citation to enhance one's reputation, and if your friend has worked on some beautiful piece of work and you have cited those that article because it's your friend, it's not the way that we look. And we don't take any stringent action when these kind of things happen. We ask an author to draft explanation for why there was a citation bias. This is a very important thing, authorship dispute. We usually get this kind of thing. The third author writes that I should be second, or the fourth writes I should be the third one, or someone has been added which hasn't contributed. I think in the morning we have discussed that what is a criteria for an authorship. In a nutshell, I would say that the person who has intellectually as well as technically have a role in a article, he should be given an authorship. And nowadays, I think PLOS ONE has started that in the authorship list, they have to supply that which figure has been created by which author. So it has been mandated by PLOS ONE nowadays that you have to figure it out that this figure has been generated by X author. So these are different criteria of guest author when you include some author who hasn't contributed in your study, but for that you have to remove an author, and that's something which is really bad. So another thing is a data fabrication. You cannot have a partial data given to a publisher and saying that this is a positive result and omit the negative results. Every publishing house, irrespective of the journal, have a software to detect whether the data has been fabricated or not. So be aware of this thing. And our criteria say that research misconduct is defined as fabrication or falsification in proposing, performing, or reviewing research, on reporting research results, and manipulating research material, equipment, or process of changing or omitting data or results. So if you are changing the instrument, changing the parameters, that also comes under data fabrication. In that case, we go to the laboratories and ask for the raw data and the instrument before concluding something. So under COPE, these are the three terms which we look for. Trimming is altering one's data. It's a partial picture you have, you know, provided to a journal, or provided a black and white in a one journal and colored picture in another journal. So we have all the softwares to do that. Cooking is the selective reporting of our data, and forging, making up of our data. There was a very good Iranian author, good in the fact, I will not name him, good in the fact that he was very proficient in taking others' data and writing a research article. So he, without doing any research, he has published around 22 articles, and one was in tumor biology. And when we got suspected, we got a complaint, and we went to find it out whether his laboratory is working on a particular subject and what the instrument he has. You will, we were found shocking that he runs a coaching center only. Okay, he didn't have a laboratory, he didn't have anything, but he has a coaching center which he was running for MSc and for PhD to get them admission. And he was having 22 research articles in a year, and in a reputed tumor biology also that has an impact factor of around 3 to 4 now. So when we do these kind of things, we found that we usually retract a manuscript and notification of our employer and a publication ban. And it definitely gives a very bad name to the authors, to the institute, if a retraction has happened in a journal. And it was also is a bad thing for us also when an article has to be retracted, because a lot of efforts has been done to print or to publish an article, okay, from the authors, from the reviewers, from the editor-in-chief, from the production phase. It costs a lot of time and money. So you please be aware of this fact.